So when I was a teenager, my mother joined an organization called the Samaritans. It was the first charity in the United Kingdom to set up a suicide hotline. And she used to travel into the center of London and sit in a cold basement in a church in front of some telephones and talk to desperate people. And one Christmas break, she asked me to join her. I was terrified. I didn't think I could do anything, and I was certain I couldn't help. But she reassured me and told me she'd be there and told me that she thought I could do something. The first call I took was from somebody who was going to kill themselves by swallowing a bottle of tablets. We talked, or rather I listened, and in the end the caller threw away the tablets and thanked me. And that taught me that I could do something, that even listening to someone else's story can be helpful. And I think that's something that anyone can do, whatever your background. So I'm a psychiatrist now, and you probably think that there's more I can do than just listen, and you're right, there are many treatments that I can give. But that, in a way, is why it's so frustrating, because I don't know what's going to work for which people. I don't know when is the best time to give treatments, and there are going to be occasions when no treatments work at all. While I was working in Oxford, I had to look after the wife of an Italian restaurant owner who had become very severely depressed for the first time in her life in her 40s. And I do what I've been trained to do. I tried psychotherapy, I tried various antidepressants, and the only consequence of my effort was that she overdosed on the medication, and I had to take her into hospital where her condition continued to deteriorate so severely that she lost weight and put her own life at risk. So I resorted to a treatment which has a very bad reputation, electroconvulsive therapy. Remarkably, within a couple of weeks, she'd made such a good recovery that we could discharge her, and it was almost as if nothing had happened. And it left me thinking, why didn't I know that before? Why didn't I know how to treat this person at the right time and to avoid this? And the reason I'm standing here, and the reason that you know this is such a big problem, is because we don't really understand what causes depression. And that's the question that we have to address if we're going to make any progress. And that's why I left Oxford, 25 years I'd been there, to come to UCLA. UCLA has put at the center of its mission to cure depression a study to find the causes of depression. It's had the courage and the ambition to embark on this on the appropriate scale, a study of 100,000 people. And I wanted to join that. Now, the reason depression is so hard to study and the reason we need to do it on this sort of scale is because it's not really one disease. Trying to find the causes of depression is a bit like trying to understand what causes cancer without knowing that there's leukemia, bowel cancer, skin cancer, having those all mixed together without knowing that they have separate routes, separate pathways. You probably know people who are unhappy all the time without apparent reason. And then there are others who survive life's worst calamities without apparent distress. And others still who meet some stressful life event and become extremely depressed. Why is it that some people succumb and others don't? And perhaps one of the deepest mysteries of this disorder, why is it that people with depression sometimes have completely opposite symptoms? Some people lose their appetite, lose weight, can't sleep. Others sleep more and put on weight. So if we're going to answer these questions, we need to collect information about people's mood and about what happens to them. And we need to do this over a long time. Depression is a recurrent disorder. The way that currently we do this is by talking to people, by clinical interviews. And not only is this slow, it's not really going to be suitable for 100,000 people, but it's also inaccurate. I need to know about my patient's sleep, and I talk to them about that. But we know that people's memory of their sleep is notoriously poor. Unlike physicians, I can't order a blood test. I can't order an imaging study. I don't have an objective measure of mood until now. UCLA is transforming the way we collect these data, working with psychologists, computer scientists, engineers. We've developed a behavioral health tracking system. Let me show you how this is. So I bet everyone has one of these. And you will use it to get information. You read posts on social media, Google searches, and so on. Well, we want to use this to collect information about your mood. And let me just give you one example of how this will work. You'd accept that when people get depressed, there's a change in their voice. They might speak more slowly, or the quality of the voice might change in some way. Well, we've been working with engineers, and we found that from a 4-second voice recording, we can now make a diagnosis of depression with about 90% accuracy. And although we haven't got there yet, we're pretty certain that from that same recording, we can also make a prediction as to whether somebody is thinking of killing themselves. And when I say a 4-second recording, I don't mean a clinical interview. This is just innocuous stuff like, where do you live, what's your address, things like that. So you can see that with that technology, we can make a diagnosis early, we can offer treatment early, and potentially we can save lives. So we've begun to use this technology amongst the student population, and we've also begun to use it in the clinics here, and we've targeted two groups. We've targeted the elderly, and you'd realize that the reasons that the elderly get depressed are very different from those that affect the student population. And the second group that we've targeted are those where depression is really at its most pernicious. And that's the mothers of newborn infants. You know, it's a terrible thing to see a woman who cannot care for her child because she is so depressed, all she can do is cry and think of killing herself. We want to stop that. So we're offering our behavioral health system to all of those attending the maternity clinic, integrating it with their standard care so that we can detect this disorder early and offer appropriate treatment. UCLA's mission doesn't stop at treating people in this city. We want to cure depression everywhere. And we've been thinking about ways to do this. So last year I went to Taiwan and I presented what we've done at UCLA to the Ministry of Health. And the minister told us that depression is a problem. They've recognized for a time that suicide is a major health concern for them, and they don't have a policy. So they applauded what we've been doing here, and they've allowed us to pilot a Chinese version of our behavioral health system in one of the hospitals in Taipei. And I expect that we'll extend that to other hospitals and eventually to the entire island. So I hope that soon we'll be engaging with people across the world so that we can tackle the world's single biggest cause of suffering. Everywhere people are suffering from depression, and everywhere the treatments that we offer are failing them. I think the enormity of this problem, being faced by the misery of someone with depression, it's something that we find very hard, and we feel helpless in front of this. And when the only people that seem to help us or be able to come up with solutions are going to be scientists whose lives and approaches seem so remote from our own, all of this conspires to distance us from the people who suffer from depression, to reinforce that sense of helplessness. And I started by telling you about how helpless I felt in front of somebody who wanted to commit suicide. I think most of us don't want to get involved with depression because we feel not only that we can't help, but maybe we'll make things worse. But while depression is foreign in many ways, the misery and the sadness are something that's really an extension of everyday experience. And everyone is touched by this disorder at some level. We know what misery and sadness are like, and we know people who've been depressed. This is a problem that we all have to face. So I've told you how I learned that I wasn't helpless, and what I've learned and what I can do. I think you can do too. Just learning about depression, about the disease, and being able to reach out to those with depression. Everyone can do that. Everyone can help. And just listening, that's helping too. Just as you are all doing right now. Thank you.